Welcome to today's episode of the Innovation Squadcast. We're going to talk about student ownership. We know that student ownership is really important for engagement and learning, and teachers are starting to ask how they can engage their students more, and one of our answers is student ownership. So I want to welcome everybody, and I'm Lindy Valachek.
I'm Jimmy Kate.
Kate O'Leary.
I'm Pam Hubler.
All right. So what's the big deal about student ownership?
I think for, when we see students really engaged, they have that agency and that voice in their learning. So they're really the motivators for their learning, their options, and how they engage with their teacher and other students in their classroom.
The biggest thing that I've found with student ownership is that the students usually will always exceed the expectations that I had for whatever project or learning, because they get excited, they get into the material, they really start to get that deeper learning in there, and then what they turn out and what they produce usually is way better than what I could even imagined or thought of myself. And so that's what I found the one of the most exciting things about giving students the chance to show how they learn whatever they want, just by that exceeding the expectations and learning more than they would have any other way. So.
And that also translates into real life. So when they're not in school, you know, still having that ownership, because what they do inside of school doesn't stop there. And so it can transfer to that.
So Jimmy, how do you empower your students to make their own decisions?
Project-based learning is a big part of what I do in U.S. history at Stratford. And so, you know, I give them directions and requirements of what obviously the material has to be. They're hitting the standards, and then kind of open it up to, like, however you want to present that. It's kind of up to you. Now, a lot of times I may say I want a podcast or I want a this or that, but then even inside of I always have the asterisks. If you want to do something else, feel free to, you know, explore that, because you'll find that students have certain passions. Like, I have one group, they love doing podcasts. And so that's where they kind of tend to go. But then I also make sure that, you know, I don't want the same thing over and over again. So like this time they had to have animation to it. And so they created this whole time traveling animation Among Us newscast podcast thing that was really cool that they had done today. And so, yeah, just seeing that passion, you're going to get students to get that passion out of it. And so that's the biggest probably, ways to do that, just to give them a little choice, let them find that passion, but make sure those requirements, at least they're there, to make sure your standards and learning is taking place at the same time.
So, and getting to know your students too. So when you're providing those options, you know, to have that option for podcasting for those kids, if they have never experienced that before, they're like, oh, well, this is really interesting, engaging, but you might have those kids that this is not my jam, this is not working for me. So having a variety of choices for all of your students to really engage meaningfully.
And having them be comfortable to come up to you and say, hey, I really think I can show you that I've mastered the content by doing this, and saying, yeah, great, go for it. Let's see how it works.
Yep. Because like my Real TV students, they'll use the Real TV option when they're doing newscasts. And then you'll have others that just want to do something else. And so, and that comes with everything. Like when we're using Book Creator, some want to use Book Creator and love it. Some like to draw their own and put their own art. Some want to make a physical book, right? And so we have all those different choices inside of that, and loving those students just to explore whatever they're most passionate about is, I think, the key. And once when in that excitement, and you get students that are excited and they're having fun and they're enjoying being there, it just makes the day so much better. That's what I found. And I'm excited to go, because I'm excited to see what they're about to do and produce. And so that's always been such, you know, one of the best things I've learned about loving the kids, just to kind of own their own learning. So.
And I love how you said there that they're not allowed to do the exact same thing every time. Yeah. So you are pushing them out of their comfort zone a little bit, so they don't get stuck on one thing. So I really like that. You are pushing them. It's not just, I want to do this, so I'm sticking to it. But you're, you know, having that conference with them, and it's not just the student or just you, it's both of you together.
If you gave students choice, a lot of time you're going to get, like in high school, we get a lot of Google slides. If you just say, you know, you get to pick whatever way. And I found that the first year that I tried some, you know, learning and ownership and choice. And I'm like, all right, we can't have Google slide every time. So it's going to be, Google slides can be great, but we got to, this time, if you're going to use a Google slide, you need to screencastify it, right? So you're going to make a video out of it. If you're going to do, sometimes it's like, I need to have these journals done, right? So however you want to show these journals, right? Either through a scrapbook or through a video documentary, or, you know, so there's different ways that they can present the thing that you want, but allowing them to have the freedom to kind of, show it in their own way. So
if you're a teacher who has never given choice to students, where would you suggest people start?
I would say start with just maybe picking like an either or, right? You know, I want you to do this or I need you to do that. And then kind of see where it goes, right? And that's kind of what I did. I started with that and then let the students kind of maneuver their way. And then they're going to find where once the students feel like they're comfortable to get that voice, they're going to come to you and they're going to say, can we do this? Can we do that? Can we do a TikTok? Can we do that? Right? I've had that one, you know, absolutely. Let's see what we can do. Can we use Minecraft? I have no idea what that is, but let's see what you can do, right? And that was exactly what happened. Like, I don't even know what Minecraft is. And then they turn in and they have Lusitania blowing up and showing unrestricted submarine warfare. Yeah, and I was like, that's incredible, right? And so, and then, you know, and then even had other kids show like the Columbian Exchange and had all these things going back and forth. And so, so it's just sometimes you just let the kids kind of maneuver their way, see what it happens. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, and that's perfectly fine in a classroom. So.
And you don't have to be the expert as the teacher. No. It gives them that ownership. And also you learn things from your kids and they love to be able to show you something new. And so that's great.
Yeah, absolutely. Never used Minecraft in my life. Yeah. Never seen it, never even heard of it. And then all of a sudden now I was inundated by projects once they realized they could use and love in Minecraft. And there was collaboration going on at the same time. Like they can build together and then they would record themselves maneuvering and they had all these little characters. I'm like, you guys have fun, do it. So.
And those conversations during that collaboration are sometimes the most meaningful just to listen to them. Like they're using content words that you would have never thought they would have used to explain. So that deeper learning is definitely happening and taking place.
Yeah, and we asked some of the teachers at your school, and I know Cameron Howard kind of had the same answer as you. Most of her unit projects are choice-based assessments where students can showcase their mastery. So that's awesome. Yeah. That's not, you know, that what you're doing in your classroom is obviously starting to catch on in your school. And
she does a great job at our school teaching English, and she's a former student of mine, so that kind of helps as well in AP US History. But you know, she's doing a great job as an English teacher there, and giving her students options. And had a choice to build like a movie poster the other day from Julius Caesar, and they had to use like a quote and a visual, and they had these great Canva movie posters they created from the Julius Caesar play. So yeah, she does a really good job of giving them a lot of choice. And and you can see when you walk into the classroom, students are engaged, they're getting after it. And it's just really fun to see them walk into a classroom. So.
And I think that word you just said, engagement, that is like just a huge piece.
Absolutely.
That, you know, we really need students engaged, and what a better way.
Absolutely.
All right. So goal setting. I know this is like your favorite thing,
yes.
But like I'm a brand new teacher to trying to get students to own their learning. Talk to me about goal setting.
Well, and, you know, probably with high school, they can do more independent, but even as a class, like, all right, you know, you're working on your choice activities today, pick an accountability partner. Pam is going to be my accountability partner. I'm going to check in with her halfway through, you know, my work time just to make sure they're on task and working. And it doesn't have to be very, you know, detailed goal, like just stay working on task. Right. And then you can hold each other accountable for that.
High school definitely needs that too.
So yeah. So like kindergarten, yeah. So it works.
And you can have that conversation with younger kids too. I've seen it in the kindergarten classroom where it's just, what's your goal for today? Well, I want to be on green when I leave. What do you have to do to be on green when you leave? And then having those conversations at the end of the day where, how do you think you did? And I mean, they might be 5 or 6, but you can still have those conversations every day.
And I feel like that is something that we use throughout life, setting those goals. I think about my day. When I start my day, I'm like, okay, these are the things I need to get done, but how do I make sure that I accomplish these items? And, you know,
and if I didn't get to it today, it has to be priority tomorrow.
Yeah, absolutely.
So we call it in high school, we call it in our class, prioritize and execute, right? Here's what I got to get done, right? Let's execute that task and let's get those check boxes taken care of today. So here's what's due tomorrow. So, and I have the, you know, the choice, obviously, to what they're going to work on, but. Yeah, we definitely need that in high school just as much as anything else, too.
Yeah, getting ready for life.
I like the idea of having, the, you know, what are we going to accomplish today? Like, I have my Google check-in that they do at the beginning of every class, and I just, you know, how are you doing? Anything I need to know? I think adding in maybe another question of, like, what do I want to accomplish today? And then if they can write that down and that gets into their head, that may actually focus them a lot more. I might add that to my Google form check-in. I like that. You know, what am I going to accomplish today? And then set that goal and see if they can meet it.
Yeah, and I wonder how many of those kids are, like, check, like, a the check off. I need to write it down, and then I need to put that check mark next to it to make sure that I have accomplished.
I use Google Keep for mine. The best feel in the world when you knock off that Google Keep and the box goes empty. You're like, yes.
You know, you can do check boxes in Google Docs now.
You can, yes.
That's my new favorite.
Yeah. That was one of my tech tips for my school. When I learned about that, I'm like, oh, they need to know this.
Yeah, absolutely. That's like, you know, so, such a little detail, but it makes life so much easier.
And using real sticky notes, I have had students before where they're like, I don't want to use technology, but the sticky note is one of those because they take it, ball it up, throw it in the trash, I'm done, and they love it. So it works either way.
Yeah, and there was a teacher at Macedonia Middle School that used sticky notes for like kind of that student ownership. How do you like to learn? And they would write down and then they would revisit it after a week. Now, you know, I like to learn in with a partner. Okay, well, how did you do this week learning with a partner? And some of them really kind of owned, okay, maybe I'm not good at that. Well, is it that you're not good at you're doing learning with a partner, or is it that you didn't pick the right partner? So there's that whole goal setting of reverting back to what does a good partner look like? Let's reflect on it, that kind of stuff.
We were working with a teacher who did student reflections in Flipgrid, and there was this little one, elementary, I chose the wrong partner today. Just because I didn't get any of my work done when we talked. But even, you know, just that reflecting, like, that wasn't a good choice. Right. And I'll make a different one tomorrow.
That's huge. Absolutely.
Yeah. And so it doesn't have to be, I think people think, you know, personalized learning is this big, but it starts small. I think I like what you said, start small and, you know, go from there.
Absolutely.
And listen to your kids. They're going to tell you way more information than you need to know, but giving them that choices, they'll tell you what choices are going to work best for them.
Another shout out to a teacher at our school, Ms. McNamee. She started a little personalized learning with her class. Yes. And so it was just, you know, walked in there, saw that they were doing vocabulary. So you had some kids who had, you know, got to a certain level and they're drawing their words. You know, other kids that are taking them and making index cards, right? So they had choice on how they wanted to demonstrate what they knew about their vocabulary and what was best, you know, for them learning. And so just to see that differentiation was, you know, huge inside that classroom. And you have kids excited about drawing, and they were drawing these amazing things about, you know, imperialism. And it was like, you know, that, and then they're probably always going to remember now because they got that, you know, that art that goes along with it, but that's not for every student.
Right. And so y'all talked about reflecting. Okay. How often do students need to reflect? I mean, is that a,
so with our, we have e-portfolios, we reflect on every time we finish a project, right? So when they upload their portfolio, they reflect, they have two paragraphs they got to create. It's one on, you know, what did I learn, right? Or, you know, what information that I put in here that they know. And then the other one is what work and life skills that they use, or what level of the four C's, right? I collaborated, I communicated, I used a lot of resilience in this project when we did CoSpaces. That was a lot of resilience, because CoSpaces can be difficult for kids when they're building those, you know, we built museums. And so, so just using those work and life skills, and so they're reflecting on how is this benefiting me and how am I growing as a person. So.
And if you're teaching with youngers, it could just be a simple thumbs up, thumbs down. How do you feel like your behavior was?
Yeah.
At the end, it can be very private, like, well, the two about, you know, thumbs up, thumbs down, and do it with academic and behavior. You know, how do you feel like you did with multiplying one-digit numbers today? And get a lot of this sometimes, but it doesn't have to be this difficult thing. And it could just be in a one-to-one conference too.
Absolutely.
As you're doing those informal conversations during class.
And okay, so my last question, I think, is how do kids in your class know their progress?
So, you know, whenever we look at the projects and it's uploaded to their portfolio, then we break them down as a class and we watch them, and then we talk about, we debrief, you know, at the end too. Sometimes I'll debrief each project. Sometimes I debrief like the whole experience, because sometimes I'll create like a situation in my classroom where it's like, all right, I'm the CEO of this company. I got these two teams. I need this product by this date. Who's going to turn in the best product, right? And then I'll assign like a team leader to each one. And so they have to learn some leadership skills as well. And then we'll debrief on those leadership skills. Did we have good, clear communication amongst everybody? And they're like, no, I could have done a better job of communicating this, right? And this idea of ownership, not just in their learning, ownership in their life, and taking ownership. And when, you know, I didn't communicate clearly exactly what needed to be done, I didn't, you know, make sure that I had the tasks, you know, prioritized and executed. And so we reflect either individually versus on the project, or sometimes we'll debrief as a group on just overall leadership skills. And that's what that ownership allows. It's not just about the knowledge. Sometimes it's about those skills that they can take with them when they move on.
Pam, you've been in a lot of classrooms. How have you seen other teachers approach that data tracking type?
There are some that have the visuals in the classroom, and that takes a lot of transparency and trust within the class, so it just depends. But then there are some that just like to track and check off in like a notebook, or the primary grades are a good example of that, because the kids, if they are given like a little check, then okay, we've got this, and you know, even smiley faces, you name it, like any of those little things that you can do to just see your progress.
I think that's all, it goes back to having something tangible to go back to. Like, okay, well, I was really strong. Maybe in the morning, I was great. I rocked up this afternoon, it was a hot mess. So I know I need to focus on the afternoon for my task and my goals.
Well, did y'all have anything else y'all wanted to add? Any tips or tricks that, you know, teachers?
Just allow the students to explore. I think once you, like I said, they will blow you away with what they're going to create when they're passionate about and they're excited about what they're doing. Right. I remember one day I was, you know, I would just sit in my classroom. All my kids were, you know, working and doing this, and they're having all these conversations. I'm just sitting there smiling. One of my teachers, she was looking at me and goes, "What are you doing?" I'm like, "I'm just happy you guys are learning." And like, yeah, we're having a great time. Or that day where the kids are like, you know, it's 10:20, and I start, "All right, guys, time to pack up." And they're like, "No, wait a second. We got this to do." Right. That's just one of the better feelings you'll get as a teacher. And that's what ownership, I think, will do more than anything else.
And it seems hard and difficult. Start small. You know, as teachers, we want to keep that control because, you know, we feel like we have to manage everything. Do it in baby steps. Do a little bit here and there. Have choice with this, but maybe not with something else.
Absolutely.
So is it just, here's your independent work, or here's how your assessment choices can look today?
Right.
Or working with a partner, working by yourself. Just little things that you can do to make the shift.
And even with the students that have, whether you have kids that have learning disabilities or have anxiety, just, you know, say, pick one or the other, just pick one. You choose, pick one. And if they can't, okay, this is your list for today. We'll see how much you can get done. You don't have to do all of them, but, you know, and then that could be even where you goal set as far as, okay, there's five options here. Just, we have to do two.
Yeah, absolutely.
So we don't want to stress them out. So, you know, just kind of thinking about all those different kids and how they learn.
Absolutely.
So our mailroom question, I guess, for our listeners would be, you know, what does student ownership look like in your classroom, sound like, and or do you have a question you're wanting to start some allowing students to own their learning? And you have some questions on how to get started, leave us a message either on the Anchor app or through our social media posts.
Absolutely.
All right. Well, you guys have a great day.
All right.
Bye.
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 Bye.